I was born in Providence, Rhode Island, in July 9th, 1920.
Was it in, did you grow up in the city then?
Yes, it was in the city. That's where the, when the immigrants came from Italy, they settled in a place called Federal Hill. That's was high, not a mountain, but high, very high. It gets a beautiful state house for a view. It's equal to the Washington State House.
Yeah. What was it like growing up in an urban place like that? What'd you do for fun in the summers, that kind of thing?
There was no such thing as there was playgrounds, local playgrounds, but there was no beaches, anything like that. You know, no one had any swimming pools or anything like that. That's just a thing of the past.
Did you like growing up there?
Yes, I did.
Why?
Well, I put it this way. When my parents came over, they lived on Spruce Street. And then from Spruce Street, we graduated to another area, a little nicer. There was a playground right across the street. But I don't remember this. But then we moved to a street called Albro Street. And my older sister, my sister Santa said, says, gee, Carmen is lost. And what happened to him? I was only 5 years old, you know. I don't remember this. They says, one of the neighbors says, oh, says, there's a boy down at the police station. It's a central police station. And what happened is this officer came along and bought me a cone of ice cream. And there I was sitting on his desk eating the ice cream. And my sister came in to save me. You know, I remember that. But then what happened is my parents lost a brother who was a bit older than myself. His name was Ben Michael. And so we moved away. We moved to a nice area, Silver Lake section. And that's where I grew up from 1925 up until I got married, you know.
Did the Depression affect your family?
Yes, yes, it did. We were very, very poor. And my parents, they were farmers. And they knew how to grow things, no getting away from it. But we didn't grow it just for ourselves. You know, we had a three-tenement house in Silver Lake, or I should call it the Annex section. And we grew beautiful fruits and vegetables. And there's one thing I want to point out is my dad, even though I lost him at an early age, he died in 1935, but he had an apple tree, and he was so good at grafting. We had an apple tree with seven varieties of fruit, including pears growing on an apple tree, you know? And I'll never forget that. You know, he was good at that. And one day, there was a squash growing on the tree. You know, and his friend came over and said, "Hey, Dominic, you grafted squash into the tree." You know, and my father, he was comical. He made him believe that he grafted a squash on a tree. I'll never forget that. Yeah.
When you were growing up, when you were a kid, did you like school?
Yeah, well, you know, most, you know, I liked the elementary school, but because of depression and losing my dad at an early age, I went to 1 year of high, and it's very important. You know, you say you have to have a college education. Well, at 1 year of high, when I left junior high school, I went to a trade school, and I learned cabinet making, and you'd be surprised how much that helped me out. Yeah, it really did. The situation with Pearl Harbor, I wanted to enlist right away. I really did.
Why?
Because of the feeling of being an American, you know? Yeah, it might, let me put this point to you. When my parents came here from Italy, we belonged to a religious society. And once a year they would have a procession. And I was just a little boy, maybe no more than maybe 8 or 10 years old. And they didn't have money. And my dad bid to carry the American flag, you know? And this flag was big and heavy. They had to wear gloves and they had to put a harness around. And I could still picture myself walking with him. He was so proud to be in those days you had to have a first papers and a second papers. And he had his first papers, but he passed away. He never got his second papers. And even today, when I write my name on a check, it brings back memories of when he used to go to school to learn how to write. And I still remember that, you know. It was never straight across. It was always on an angle.
Well, did you join up then?
No. No. What happened is my mother says, Carmen, in Italian, says he called me Carmen. You know, you don't have a dad. He says, when the government calls you, then you go. Well, first of all, when my mother, I didn't want to disappoint my mother, and I joined the Rhode Island State Guards. We had uniforms with the Rhode Island patch, you know, and we protected the reservoir. That's the first thing to protect is the reservoir, and I'm so proud that I belong to that. And believe it or not, they inducted us as FBI men, as the Rhode Island State Guards, you know, and my record when I got inducted into the service, my commander came right down to the railroad station and gave me my discharge. And I'm back in my report, it showed that I was a member of the Rhode Island State Guard. And that helped me out because when I got in the service, I was training soldiers, you know? Yeah, you know.
Well, take me through the story then of when you were called up. What happened?
When they called me up and got the letter from President Roosevelt in 1942, yeah, it says you were inducted.
And so what happened after that?
After that, if you could see the parents that came to the train station, these mothers were screaming. It says, oh, my children, my son, the Providence Station. And we got on the train and we went to Fort Devens, Massachusetts. And
what were your feeling? Were you excited, or you know?
I just wanted to be a part of America. You know, that was my aim. Yeah.
Was there a strong feeling of patriotism then?
Oh yes, patriotism is true.
So we got you at Camp Devon. What happened?
Right there in Camp Devens. You strip all your uniform, your civilian clothes, and before you know it, they give you shoes, socks, and trousers, and everything else. You know, yes, that's true. Then they get you in drilling. You know, so we're there for a few months. I'm not sure exactly how much time, and then we got transferred to basic training in Bangor, Maine. Cold, very very cold. You know, this was in 1942.
Did you like basic training, or was
it
awful?
Well, we liked it, but you know, like any GI, you would complain if your feet were sore or too much walking or things like that. Yeah.
Yeah. Were you getting into the best shape of your life?
Oh yes, that was good. Yeah, a lot of hiking. Yeah.
So you're in Maine. Where'd it go from there then?
From Maine, we were transferred to Syracuse, Syracuse Air Base, and very, very cold up there, you know.
They keep sending you to these cold places.
Yeah, that's right. Very.
And so this in New York?
Yeah, Syracuse, New York, yeah, upstate.
So you're getting this training. At some point, are you getting a direction on where you're going to end up?
You had no idea. You had no idea where you're going to. So that's we start learning about ammunition and bombs and the components of what went into the bombs, you know, and that's what we were training for that. Yeah.
Did you like it? Was it interesting?
Yes, it was very interesting because, you know, down deep in your heart, you know there's a war going on and you just wanted to get into it, you know?
Yeah. So you're getting trained on ordnance and things
ordnance.
Of that sort.
Yes.
Before the service, did you know a lot about that, guns and bullets and ammunition? Did you know any of that stuff?
The only thing I knew about ammunition is I worked for a novelty company, and those days we were selling fireworks. Yes, we sold fireworks. I was like a delivery man. I used to deliver to the variety stores and all that, you know. That's all I knew about ammunition.
So you got the basic training then, and you're learning about ordnance. What happened after that then?
After ordnance, after Syracuse, I would say, right? Well, let me put this point. From Rhode Island to Syracuse, my mother and brother and sister came on a bus. 12 hours. And the commander says, DiChiaro, your family's waiting for you at the post. Take the afternoon off and go see them. And there I was with fatigue clothes, with this round hats and everything else. I'm waiting at the gate, and I'm looking for them. I didn't see them. Then my sister looked out of the MP post gate, and she saw me sitting on a boulder. You know, I said, oh, there's Carmen right there. And she, this is something. They had a bag of apples. And when the guard saw those apples, he says, oh my God, where do you people live? I said, we're from Rhode Island. These apples were that big. One apple would make an apple pie. You know, I says, Ma, I can't eat all. Give them to the guard. He couldn't believe it. He couldn't believe it. Isn't it? Now we're getting ready to go overseas. Now they shift us to Fort Dix, New Jersey. And we're stationed at an air base. Well, Syracuse was an air base also. But in New Jersey, I was living in a combat zone. We didn't have huts, we had tents. We slept in tents. That's what we did. And it was, in other words, getting ready to go overseas, cooking outdoors. Nothing, you know, make a fire, just to boil the water, to get acclimated to being away from, you know, from the States. That's what it was.
Did you have any idea where you were going?
I have no idea. The only thing you have to look for is, well, if they issue a khaki uniform, then you're going to go to the Pacific. But if they give you a woolen uniform, then you're going to go to Europe. And then we got our uniforms. We're going to Europe. That's what it was.
So you got the woolens.
We got the woolens. Yeah, yeah.
What was? Do you remember what your feeling was? I mean, to learn.
This sergeant says we were lined up for roll call, and said, "Look, tomorrow we're leaving." Now, anyone that doesn't want to leave, speak up. And you know something? We had one gentleman that stepped forward and says, he didn't want to go. You know, he started to cry. We're a good outfit. And he says, no, he says he's got problems at home. He had a dad was had an amputated foot, and he just wanted to stay back. And there was no questions asked.
Do you remember what the mood of everybody was when they found out they were going to go to Europe?
They were excited. They were ready to go, believe me, ready to go. And you know what happened? It's the first time says, they always call you by your surname, DiChiaro. He says, go around to the men, get as much money as you can. Here's a false trip ticket. Go to a place called New Egypt in New Jersey and get whatever they want. You know, I'm talking about booze. And sure enough, we had a phony trip ticket. We got out the MP post. We came back with a lot of booze. And coming back, and one soldier says, DiChiaro, hide the truck. Some of the official is looking for you. I said, well, what are we going to do? So I said to my driver, and I said, look, you go one way and I'll go the other way. And then we'll make up a story what happened. And sure enough, he said, DiChiaro, where you been? You know, you're supposed to have roll call every hour, you know? So he says, I lied. He says, I took a walk in the woods and I fell asleep under the tree, you know? He says, you're supposed to be here every hour for roll call. You know? And then after he left, oh my God, you can't believe it. We were all so happy. We were all so happy, honest. We had a good time.
So all of the alcohol got consumed?
It got all, was consumed. You know, I'm from Rhode Island, and we're surrounded by water. And we got on the troops always moved at nighttime. We got on a train to go to New York, and we got on a ferry, and I said, oh my God, how is this thing gonna cross the ocean? I thought that was the boat that we're gonna cross the Atlantic with. Then we're going to pull into Staten Island, and there's a big, big ship. You never know the name of it, you know? So one of the fellows says, you're going to go on one of the queens. I said, oh, then we knew, guaranteed, we're going to go to Europe.
Do you remember which queen, which ship
yes,
it was?
Yes, yes, I remember.
Which one was it?
Queen Elizabeth.
What do you remember about the journey across?
I remember. When I put my foot on the gangplank, and one of the officers got a chalk, and he marked a number on my helmet, and I made the sign of the cross. I said, "Dear God, make this a two-way ticket." I remember that.
Yeah. It was, wasn't it?
It was. It really was. Yeah.
Well, you get on ship, you get the mark on the helmet.
Right.
And what was it like on the ship? All those guys going across there.
My Alpha was very fortunate. We didn't have to switch our cabin. A cabin where usually sleeps two people, there's about 20 and stacked, you know, stacked up way up high like that, you know. And the other fellas, they slept for 8 hours, they get out of their bunks, go up on top of the deck, and another crew came in. That's how it was.
How did that many guys eat? I mean, how did you get your chow?
Two meals a day, and most of them ate, they had a PX where you used to buy, you buy a whole a box of Hershey bars, you know? That's what most of them lived on, you know?
How do you occupy your time? All that. I mean, what do you do during that time?
Well, I'm not a gambler, but most of the fellas, they were shooting crap. That's what they were doing, you know? But I wasn't a gambler.
What would you do? I mean, did you just kind of sit and talk all day, or was there something
yeah,
to do?
Yeah, that's all you could do was just sit and talk, you know? You know, it's and I'd look at the hungry ocean. Oh, they give you a preserver with a flashlight. And what you do is you turn the top and the light goes on. I said, well, how are you going to survive in that ocean, that hungry ocean? Oh, I mean, you know, the Queen Elizabeth is bigger, 85,000 ton. It was like a matchstick in the ocean.
Yeah. Was there a fear of submarines?
Yes, there was. Yeah. At one time we were, I could be mistaken, but one time we all had to go down below. And there was firing up above. Yeah.
what was the mood on the ship? Were people excited, bored? What did it feel like to be on that ship?
Oh, they were all so happy, happy just being a soldier, being an American. Yeah, yeah. We went over. Listen, we went over the first bunch of waves. Well, I should say waves. No, WACS, a woman's army corps. Yeah. Yeah.
Did you mix at all with the WACS? I mean, did you
talk?
No,
no.
They were in a separate part.
They were separate part. Separate part. Separate part. That was in May 1943. Yeah.
Did you know where you were going at that point? I mean, were you going to England or?
We didn't know where we were going to land. We never gave you any information, you know.
Well, where did you eventually land?
We landed in Scotland. We landed in Scotland, and what happened is the ship was so big that you couldn't even come into port. We had to get off the ship, off rope ladders, into smaller vehicles, you know, and then on land.
Well, you got on land. Now you're in Europe.
we're in Europe. You know something? I said, gee, my God, I like to eat. I said, gee, where's my next meal going to come from? All I had was an apple. I had an apple that came off the Queen Elizabeth. And I went on the train, and we stopped in Edinburgh, I believe it was. And we bought some crumpets from the Scottish people, you know, with American money, you know. Yeah. Then on a ship, on a train, these English girls came in, soldiers like Women's Land Army. They were giving out potato chips in little bags, and my bag was slit open, and inside was a girl's address. Imagine that, little things you don't forget, you know. But I never did call. No, because we kept going and going and going.
And so did you go straight down to the Framlingham base?
No.
No.
Oh, no. This is very important. You won't believe it. The first place we got to called Grimsby, England. And we were at a fighter base. This was a RAF base, you know. And what happened is... Lord Haw-Haw, you heard of Lord Haw-Haw, right? He turned Nazi.
Yeah, he was a Nazi radio personality.
That's right. He announced, see, we went over as a first service group at first, and he says, we welcome the first service group, and we're going to pay you a visit. And sure and behold.
So he was threatening an attack.
He was an attack, and he did. They you can't believe what they did. They took the River Humber along the Grimsby. They say it's so full of minerals, of fish oil. And the Nazis, all they could do was from the glare from the moon, it made a reflection. And all they had to do was just follow that water. And they knew just where our base was. And they did bomb it. They did. It's the first time what an experience that was. We jumped into revetments, was full of water and everything else. But we don't know, we never knew how many casualties we had, but they did bomb us.
Do you remember what you thought at that point when the base came under attack? Did it feel like, did you finally realize, I'm in a war zone? I mean, do you remember what your reaction kind of was to all that?
Oh yeah, you knew that your heart was always in your mouth. You were worried, no getting away from it. Yeah, and we've seen planes being shot right out of the air. We see pilots bailing out. You know, the British. You know, they went up at nighttime.
Well, were you at that RAF base very long?
I got some. I was there about two or three months. I got trained by the British. Yeah, I was there. They was training us, for all the bombings they had in Great Britain. They was training us to as a firefighter. They put me on a crash tender, an English crash tender. And what happened is if a plane ever came in on fire, I was supposed to go out there with an asbestos suit and go rescue that pilot, you know?
And they were training you how to do that?
Yes, the British was training me how to do that. They were.
How did you get on with the British guys?
We got along very well. And what I did, I wasn't a smoker. I used to trade my tobacco for them. You know, they love that.
You made lots of friends.
I made lots of friends. That's right. Yeah.
What was it like on a British base in World War II? You know.
Well, it's. There was, it was just like one big happy family. Here we are, we're together, you know? There was British teachers on there, yeah.
I guess, you know, you had later experience on American bases. Well, you'd had experience on American bases. Were the British bases different than the American bases? You know, and just the way they worked?
Well, they are different. I'll tell you, when they sent me to a, it's later on, after I left Grimsby, they sent me to an RAF base outside of Liverpool. And it was just two American soldiers there, myself and this other American. And we were there for training. I was learning about there. Had to do with ammunition and bombs and things like that, you know.
Was it odd, just two Americans?
Just, we had to get this training because, see what happened is when the Battle of the Bulge came along, they were using American Air Force men to go into these places. And when it was time for me to go, my commander says, DiChiaro, I'm not going to send you. He says, we need you at the airbase. But I was experienced in firing bazookas. Yeah, we got that training from...
How to fire a bazooka.
Oh, yeah, how to fire a bazooka. Yeah.
So you're getting all this wild training.
Not only bazooka, even to fire a rifle with a launcher.
A grenade launcher?
A grenade launcher, oh, yes. Yeah, we got. Well,
did you ask why am I learning how to shoot a bazooka?
That was the Army way of teaching you. You know, you have to go there and do it.
But I guess did you ever? Why am I learning to use a bazooka? Am I going somewhere that I'm going to have to?
Yeah. Yeah, there's one thing I forgot to tell you. At that Grimsby base. Oh my God! You know what happened there? You can't believe it. The British soldier, the teacher, he says, "All right," he says, "we're going in for mine disposal, and we're ready for a class." And he looked at me and he says, "DiChiaro," he says, "go in the shed and get a spade." You know, so I mean, I was following his orders. But now, remember, this is a mine disposal class. So me, I listened to him. I went over, and I got a spade. And you know what happened? The thing blew up. But not with real explosives. He says, "See, this is your first lesson. You have to double check everything." You know. So then I'm on the ground, and I'm digging. He says, "What'd you find, DiChiaro?" I said, "Well, I found the detonator." He says, "What are you gonna do?" I said, "I'm gonna take it out." "Okay." "And then what are you gonna do?" I said, "I'm gonna dig around it." I said, "Oh, I found another detonator." He said, "What are you gonna do?" I said, "I'm gonna take it out." "Good. You gonna take the mine up?" I said, "No. No." I said, "I'm gonna dig underneath." I dug underneath and I got my mirror. I said, "There's another detonator on the bottom." He said, I says, "I'm going to dig around and get it out and then take the mine up." So I went to mine disposal school. The British trained me for that.
Take me past, and you've got all this British training and these things. I mean, where'd it go from there then?
Where it went from there is I was at the air base at Parham. But no, I got to put this in. This is important. I give my Alfred a lot of credit because the 16th, 89th, when we joined them in 1943, half the Alfred came from Africa. They fought the African campaign. And what we were doing, even though we were attached to the Air Force, you can't believe the service that we did for our country. Not as Air Force work. We were taking Jeeps and trucks. These Jeeps were all wrapped up, built in boxes. They had to be dismantled. They were all cosmoline. And my men from the 1689th had to take all that cosmoline off and assemble these vehicles. That wasn't for the Air Force. That was for the infantry. Yeah, that was for the paratroopers. You know? So the 390s got a lot of memory of helping out for the invasion forces. We finally got to Framlingham. And that's where we started. My outfit, the 1689, we had armorers, we had welders, we had mechanics, and they took care of all the vehicles, you know, replacing parts and everything else. I myself, I wound up in the bomb dump. That was my job.
Give me a job description of what you did.
My job, whenever we got orders from headquarters, we had so many planes going up, and we had to figure out how many what size bombs they were going to use. They gave us the detonators, the right size to put in, and then we had to service the full four squadrons. It all came from the 1689. They came out of the bomb dump. We were in charge. We took the bombs in. We distributed them. We had to put the fins on. The fin came into a special rack. At one time, we had to use a wrench to get them off. And we had to put the fin on the bomb. Now, the bomb is not armed until you put the fuse in. There's a nose fuse and a tail fuse. And it has a propeller on it. The bombardiers will know about this. They have an arming vane that locks the vane from the front and one to the rear. And when that bomb is dropped, the arming vane stays in the bomb bay and the propeller on the bomb rotates. When it rotates 360 revolutions, that bomb is armed. That's when it's going to go off like that.
When do you put the detonators in?
We did it. The detonators are put into the fuse at the bomb dump.
Okay, but yeah. You don't do it when they're in the plane or?
No. We had them in boxes. And on a bomb service truck with the bombs, with the fin already on, I delivered it to the plane. And then the other ordnance men from the Air Force, from the squadrons, they load up, they put the fuses in.
So you would get the bombs out to the plane.
We get out the bombs out to the planes, that's right.
How many guys did you work with in your group?
In the bomb dump, we had about 20 men. You know? But the groups, they had their ordnance men, they would come down and pick up their bombs. We didn't deliver to the planes, we just delivered to the squadrons.
What was life on the base like? I mean, where did you live?
We lived in a Quonset hut. We had a potbelly stove. Like I say, getting back to the cigarettes, I used to trade my tobacco to an English farmer, and I was able to get some fresh eggs.
and I guess that's a question. How was the food there? I mean, you know.
Well, you've got we had a lot of corned beef hash. I had mutton, which I didn't like, you know, mutton, corned beef, spam, pork chops. It wasn't the best, but it was a lot of powdered eggs, powdered onion, powdered potato, you know. And we had some fresh vegetables, you know.
How long did you serve at Framlingham? Do you remember
I that? Saved right to the very end.
Till a VE day then?
Yeah, after that, yeah.
What was it like living in a Quonset hut with all those guys?
Well, it was crowded. It was crowded. We didn't have many showers, you know. We had to, there was a cold shower we had, you know. Well, we made the best of it.
Were there, what was it, a shift like? I mean, when would you typically work? Did you work at night? Did you work during the day? Did you?
In my position, I was a crane operator. That crane operator used to lift the bombs up. And I was also an ordnance man with the fuses. And in the winter time, they would say, DiChiaro, get on the tractor and with a plow on it, and I would plow the runway. But the tractor was slow. I couldn't go along the runway this way because it would take a, you know, forever to get to the other end. So I was plowing the sideways.
Crossways, huh?
Crossways, yeah. And Mr. Mahler, Joe Mahler, came up to me one day. He says, soldier, make sure you get that corner clear, you know, where the planes come around the corner. I'll never forget it. Came right up to my tractor and told me that, you know. He said, do that. Yeah. Yeah.
Did you get, how long would a shift be then for you?
Oh, there's no such thing. You just work and you work and you work. No getting away from it. We worked hard, yeah.
So this wasn't like Monday through Friday, 9 to 5?
Oh, you couldn't, you were there from Monday to Sunday, believe me.
Was there any kind of leave? I mean, did you get any time off where you know, once in a while or?
Yes, at one time we had about 3,000 men at our field. And we were restricted for 3 months. You know why? So information wouldn't leak out. It was very important that information don't get leaked out. You go to a pub, you have a couple of drinks, your tongue gets loose, you know, you start talking. So we were restricted. You couldn't get off the base.
Do you know what the event was that caused the restriction?
Well, it's because, you know, just to let them, you know, so people would know where our next target was going to be. You got me?
You ever get into London or into Framlingham or Parham or off
yes.
the base?
Oh yes, they got off the base. They had a couple of pubs there, and the British were very, very friendly. They loved the Americans, getting away from it.
Were you able to stay in touch with your family when you were over there?
There was the only way you can get in touch with your family is just by mail, female.
V as in Victor mail?
V mail. You know how that works, don't you?
Tell us how that worked.
V mail is a form, paper form, and what happens is you put your base number on it, and they would take this V mail and they would film it. And they will not destroy that piece of paper until the film got to America. And they reproduced it. And it comes on a like a photo, and that's how you got the mail. That's how my parents got the mail.
So you were able to stay in touch V-mail with them?
With V-mail, yeah, yeah.
And did stuff come back to
they,
you?
No, they came back regular mail, but when I wrote, it went back on V-mail, and the paperwork was so heavy, so instead of using a ship to carry all this mail. When that film was delivered to America, that film was destroyed. You got me? That's how they worked that.
So they flew that film
they
back?
They flew that film back, yeah. They flew it back, yeah.
Did you like the work you were doing over there?
Oh, I wanted to get the job done. At one time, you know, being there, I've been there for all this time, since 1943, when I saw these young soldiers coming in, pilots, they didn't even haven't shaved yet, and they're flying these flying fortresses. And at one time, I said, "Gee, what am I doing here? Why don't I just volunteer and become a gunner or something like that?" It broke my heart to see these young fellas come in, and they weren't there too long. You know, they would put them on a flatbed trailer, and they would take a tour through the bomb dump, and the bomb dumps, you just like watermelons stacked up, you know. And we had quite a few revetments. At one time, we ran out of bombs, you know. We ran out of bombs, and we borrowed bombs from the Navy. And the Navy has just has one lug, so they had to adapt to make that lug fit in the bomb bay, yeah. And not only that, we had flying fortresses that had 2 1,000-pound bombs on the wings. On the wings, imagine that? And we being in the ordnance, they always put the bomb dump the furthest away from the personnel. And I'll never forget it. These planes were taking off. Oh, it was just like yesterday. And this plane is coming down the runway with these 2 1,000-pound bombs on it. And he goes off the runway. And says, there we are. We laid down flies. Oh, my God, here we go. He brought that up. Unbelievable. God bless that pilot. He made it.
So was he able to take off?
He took off.
Because it's not just those 1,000-pound bombs, it's all that fuel.
Oh, the fuel and the bomb bay full with bombs too, you know. Yeah.
were there times where the planes crashed?
The planes crashed?
Yeah.
This is the part that really gets me. Oh my God, I can't believe it. I feel so bad about this. Me being a crane operator, and I'm plowing the runway, and there was no radio signal at all. It was just a flashlight, a light signal from control tower. And they told me, says, "DiChiaro, get out there and plow that runway." And I'm plowing it sideways. And I finally got the light. Oh my God, I can't believe it. This is the part that gets me.
This is my nightmare.
I pulled my trailer, my tractor, off the runway, and this plane came in. Oh my God. The name of the plane was Lucky Strike. And he no sooner came down, his right landing gear let go. You know, and that pilot, he didn't land. He tried to bring the plane back up again. That's where it crashed. It crashed. They lost everyone on the board. It just blew up. This didn't happen at the end of the runway, into the field beyond the runway. But that's my biggest nightmare. To see that lucky strike.
Did the base ever come under attack?
They kept saying they were looking for us. Yes, at one time it did. I can only remember just once it came under attack.
What happened?
What happened is they didn't drop. Heavy explosives. I don't mind telling you this because I was going out with an English girl, and when she told her father that she was going out with a Yank, and he worked, he was an RAF man. He worked at the 390th. His name was Mr. Nichols. He said, "Oh no, you're not gonna bring an American, a Yank, to my house, you know." But he got to know me, and we got to be very good friends. So this one particular night, and we went to a little town outside of the airbase, and we just had a shanty. It's not a drink, and we took the shortcut to get back to where she lived. You know what happened there? There was an air raid that night. They didn't drop live bombs. They dropped anti-personnel bombs on the runway. And what happened is, as Joan and I, we walked that whole length of the runway, you know, and we didn't see a thing. The next morning, I'm hearing boom, boom, boom. You know, they had the sharpshooters firing at the, you know, they figured that when the planes take off, they're going to hit these anti-personnel bombs. That was a miracle.
So you walked that, right past them?
We walked right through that. That's the only time we remember that they dropped anything on our base.
Did you ever see any V-1 rockets?
Oh yes. That's another thing. One fella, one of my good friends on the Ordnance, he was on guard duty, and one bomb, V-1 or V-2, whatever it was, hit, and he was the closest one to it. And you know, he wasn't himself anymore after that. The poor guy, his hearing went and everything else, had so much problem. And just recently he passed away.
Did the V-1s go over the base?
Yes, they did. They went over the base, and what happened is, they were firing, the one that hit our base, yeah, right close to the bomb dump. Oh my God, we're so close. They were firing at it. The British were firing at those rockets to hit the fuel so it wouldn't hit and get to London. And that there must have got hit and landed close by.
Because your base was on the way to London, right?
Yeah, on the way to London, yeah. We're on the North Sea. That's where we were.
What were the living conditions there? Like, I mean, what'd you do with your off time? I mean,
We never had much off time. Went to USO Club, you know, and that's where you have a cup of coffee. There was a Salvation Army there. We go there once in a while. Yeah, there wasn't.
Here's another way to ask it. You had a British lady that you would go out with. How did you meet her?
She lived outside the base. We just happened to be walking by one day and got to know her, that's all.
I never
married her because, you know, I said to myself, and I'm so proud of myself. I said, no. I says, I'm going to keep her nice for someone, for a nice British soldier. She was young, and I said, no.
How old were you about that time?
I was about 24, and she was younger.
Yeah. Did you ever get into London?
Yes, I did.
What was wartime London like?
Oh, wartime London, pitch black, unbelievable. Yeah, but you know something? We went to a USO club, and I met Sarah Churchill. I was in her company, Sarah Churchill, and she talked about the living conditions in London. You know, and the Americans just. Listen to her.
Is it the USO club thing?
Yeah, USO. Yeah, like a Red Cross, you know. And we used to go to the Red. We never went to a hotel for a room. We always went to the Red Cross, and we could get a bunk, a bed, for maybe 2 shillings, you know. And you could take a nice hot shower. That was a thrill of that.
Did you ever go into the subway?
Yes, I did.
What was it like down there?
The subway. People used to live in a subway. People were sleeping on the hard floors, the hard concrete floors. They would take their food, the blankets and children and all. And Americans always give the kids chewing gum. They always come up and ask for chewing gum, and we gave it to them, you know.
When you were in London, was it obvious it was a war zone, or did it just look like any other city?
Oh no, that was the target. London was the main target, and you know, the sirens were going off constantly, and the barrage balloons. You heard about the barrage balloons? You know these things here? They let them up in the air, so the Germans couldn't come in, but they built these. The buzz bomb with a cutter on it, so it could cut the cable, you know, so they could cut through that.
You know, when you look back on that period, on Framlingham base, just generally. Now, what pops in your mind when you think back on that time there?
You think back, you look at those beautiful, you look at those flying fortresses and the artwork on the nose of the ship and on the tail end, the gunners, they paint different things on there. It says one gunner, Pete and repeat, and I'll never forget that, you know. And all the beautiful names, unbelievable. And you know what I used to do? When these fellas came back from the mission, I would get on my bomb service truck with maybe two or three trailers behind it, and I would go along the hot stand. I would pick these gunners up. They had to get to the headquarters because they got to go in a briefing room. And the bomb bump being so far away, you know, I said, let me get on in and give them a lift. And another thing was sad is when the wounded came in, you know, and these were shoot a flare that they had wounded on board, and the plane would land where the bomb dump was, and they would take a dead soldier out. That was sad to see. Yeah, it was sad. A lot of airmen, I don't realize, and they're so proud of my outfit, the 16th, 89th. And when we had the shuttle missions, you know, the American bombers always bombed by daytime. And when they went into enemy territory, deep, deep into Berlin, the planes came back home late at night. Now, it was up to the audience men to get these planes back down, you know, and back home. And what we did, we had this candle, like a torch, that was at the beginning of the runway, and I was on a control tower with Colonel Mahler, and he would give me an order. He would say, fire, and I would take my Zippo lighter, and I would zing him, and I would fire that rocket. And that rocket went straight up. And when the pilot saw that, that was the control tower. Anyone on board come down first, wounded with the red flare, and follow this flare at the end of the runway, you know, the beginning of the runway. And us ordnance men all along the runway were shooting these poly flares, yellow. And that's how we got all the planes in. We did that for three missions. We got every bomber home safe because of that.
So your job was not just ordnance. You had this other job of bringing those planes in safely.
Yes, that's true. Yeah.
What was it? You've mentioned a couple of times that you at least been near Colonel Mahler. What was he like? What can you tell us about him?
He was just a real gentleman, you know. It was just a pleasure to know him. You know, when he met me on the runway, he told me, he said, soldier, make sure you plow the snow away, you know. And I did, you know. And another time I want to tell you, see, being an ordnance man, we were very sensitive in the kind of fuses that we were working with. And at one time, we couldn't keep these fuses on the base because they were that sensitive. So the soldier and I, we had to go to 3rd Headquarters Division at nighttime to pick up these fuses. And we dealt with the wax. The wax would give us these special fuses and bring it back to the base. And that's what we did.
I guess that's another question is, how dangerous was the job you were doing?
It was dangerous, but you have to be careful what you were doing. You know, you have to be, you know, any kind of a spark.
Was there any sense that the war was winding down? I mean, were you aware of, the war is going to be over, we're going to get to go home? Do you remember any of that kind of creeping in?
Yeah, I figured I would never get home, you know. I always had a feeling, I look at the moon, I says, gee, Mom, I know you look at the moon, I look at the moon, you know. I never thought I'd get home, believe me.
You I mean, in a way, you were in a combat zone. I mean, the base had come under attack. You're working with bombs. But, you know, why did you have that feeling you weren't going to get home?
Because this kept going on and on and on, you know?
The war did.
Yeah, kept going on and on. Yeah.
I see. You didn't know how long you were going to stay over there.
No, I had no idea.
Well, tell me about VE Day. I mean, I'm picturing champagne and all craziness. Yeah. What was that like?
Oh, that was something. Being an ordnance, my God, we were shooting all rockets off, celebrating all that. You know, I can't believe it.
Everybody knew they were going to go home.
That's right. They knew they were going to go home.
How long were you over there after VE Day then? I mean, did you get to go away?
We got home very shortly after that. We came home on a ship, SS Samuel Griffin. Yeah, but we weren't going to come home. We were going to go to the Pacific. We were going to go to Okinawa. That was our destination, to come home and get re-equipped and go to Okinawa.
Let me talk about, you're going across on the Griffin. Was that a big ship? Were there a lot of guys on it?
It was just a steamship. It was just a troop ship. It wasn't a very big ship, no.
I'm assuming you're anxious to get home.
Oh, that's for sure.
Because how long had you been gone?
I've been gone since 43 to the end of 45. Overseas.
Right. What was the journey across like? What was the mood on the ship? Do you remember?
Oh, everyone was seasick. Everyone was. And one of my friends, Louis Vella, I think I saved his life because he wouldn't get up. He wouldn't leave the bow of the ship. You know, I used to get some soup and I'd go over and feed him. Yeah, it was bad.
So it was a kind of a rough journey.
It was a rough journey going back home. Yeah.
When you got back to the States, did you get to go home? You got to leave?
Yes, we got to leave. For a little while, and then we had to go back to. They discharged to South Dakota.
Tell me about the homecoming, though.
Oh, homecoming. I was so excited to see my parents, you know, my mother and brothers and sisters. And we met in Massachusetts. I had an aunt in Boston. And my brother-in-law drove all the way from Providence to Waltham, Mass. And we had a nice reunion right there. And then from there, we drove home.
At some point, they had victory in Japan Day so that the war was over. So obviously you didn't have to go to the South Pacific, right?
No.
Tell me about the discharge then.
The discharge, they shipped us to South Dakota, and they were just waiting what's going to happen. And they said to me, says, you want to go out and get a job, you go out and work to make some extra money. So I went to work at a woodworking company, and these big planks of wood, I don't know where they came from, Oregon or what, and you come off the freight trains, and I was stacking them, and I love that kind of work, you can't believe it.
Did you think about staying in the Army?
No.
You wanted to get on with your life and...
Get on with my life, and what happened is when I came out, I said, when I was one of my first jobs after I left school, I worked as an upholsterer, you know, and I said, I'd like to get back into it. And the reason why I left upholstering is because a man older than myself, he kept hitting me with the curved hammer, you know, with a curved hammer, boom, I said, I couldn't take it anymore. So I walked off the job, not even getting paid. I said, I'm not going back. So then when I come out of the service, I said, I was going to go back in the upholstering. And this is a good decorating company. They hired me right away because I had the experience of cabinet making, and they hired me, and I was redesigning furniture. I would take a chair, and I would design it to make it fit the person, you know, to make it higher or lower, you know, and that's how I started. And then I started doing upholstering. But you know, when you learn from the beginning, you never lose. Because you know what's happened now? In my church, when I lost Maria 3 years ago, she's up at the Veterans Cemetery in Exeter, Rhode Island.
This is your wife.
That's my wife, Maria. I says, I want to do something special for her. I upholstered all the kneelers in my church, you know, in memory of her. Every Tuesday and every Thursday for 2.5 hours, those 2 days, I said to the priest, give me 2 or 3 men to do the mechanics and I'll do the upholstery. I used 80 yards of Norga hide, 80 yards of Norga hide. And,
that's almost a football field.
Oh yeah, like a football field, you know. And I did it. And you can't believe when you do good for the church, you get rewarded. And you know how I was rewarded? Not the beauty of just doing that. People come up to me and say, "Oh, Mr. DiChiaro, thank you for the beautiful job you did." Now I had to give up the trade because of an allergy. I had to go into other businesses, you know. But you never lose what you learn, you know? And I did that. And what came out of this here, oh, you can't believe it. One person, a crippled lady, says, "Oh, Carmine, you're doing the upholstery for the church?" I said, "Yes." I said, "What is it, Mary?" She says, "I have a chair. It belonged to my mother. Can you help me out with it?" I said, "Geez," says, "you know what? I have to give up that trade because of an allergy, you know?" I said, "But for you, Mary, and for your brother, and for Maria, my wife, I'll do that chair for you." I took that chair home and I did it for her. And my children said, "Dad, what are you doing?" I said, "This is for Mary Sweeney. I mean, you know, do it for her." Oh, when I got through it to her, she can't believe it. I made her so happy. But that's not all. Then this professor teaches electronics at the University of Rhode Island. He says, "Carmen, can I talk to you after church?" "Yeah, sure." He's affiliated with the Meeting Street School. They have these children, autistic children. And what happens, he's an electrical engineer. And he says, "Have these headrests, and they're all covered in upholstery. Can you do it at Norga Hyde?" "Gladly." I did it for him. And he said, "Oh, Carmen, it came out good." He says, "How much do I?" I says, "Just pay me for the material, that's all." And know what happened?
What?
We made the delivery. He said, "Help me deliver the chair." And I went to help him deliver the chair. And Mr. Turtle, he puts the electric plug in. He puts the compressed air. And he says, "Wait a minute." The occupational therapist says, "Let me go get the patient." A little 11, 12-year-old girl, blonde, beautiful. When she saw the chair, she was so excited, you know? They sat her in the chair, and before you know it, with the mechanism and the compressed air, here comes my upholstery. Up to her face and up to her arms and her legs. I said, "Oh my God, is that what I did?" You know? So you see, you get rewarded.
Are you proud of your time in service?
Oh, yes.
Yeah,
if it's just a short time, and I'm 86 years old, and you don't come right down to it and say, "My God," when I think of the 390th, you know, I'm so proud of this, my outfit, and I got my friend Randy to join, you know, and he's sitting right behind you, you know that, and he's part of the 390th also, you know, he come right down to it, and in Tucson, my son Michael, he's the youngest of the family, and what happened to him is I took him to Tucson, and he says, "Oh, Dad," he says, he got into the hangar, where the museum was, and he cried. He says, "Dad, I didn't realize what you went through."